So, well, firstly, I'm very pleased to introduce our speakers for today. Firstly, we'll hear from respiratory and sleep physician, Dr. Hayley Barnes. Hayley completed her fellowship in 2018 and was awarded her PhD in 2022, working on improving clinical and biological approaches to improving diagnostic confidence of chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis. We'll also hear from patient advocate. Ted lives with hypersensitivity pneumonitis and is passionate about consumer advocacy. Ted spent 40 years as a lawyer in both private practice and as a member of a tribunal dealing with civil and administrative disputes. So we thank you both for joining us today and look forward to hearing from both of you. Hayley, if you're ready to get started, I'll hand over to you.
So much, Jamie, and thank you to the Lung Foundation for inviting me to speak. And I might give you a little bit of a medical overview about HP, and then I am also looking forward to hearing from our patient advocate, Ted, after this. So as an introduction to hypersensitivity pneumonitis, I thought I'd first talk about what exactly is it. So hypersensitivity pneumonitis, or HP, you know, us doctors, we always like to shorten everything. It's a lung condition which affects the lung tissue, and specifically it affects the tubes that supply the lung tissue, and then the lung air sacs called the alveoli, which make up the lungs. These air sacs receive air and oxygen that and reduce carbon dioxide, and these air sacs are also in contact with blood vessels to take oxygen around the body. So it's this area that's affected in HP. And HP is a type of interstitial lung disease, or ILD. So what causes HP? Well, it's caused by a reaction to microscopic particles from certain exposures. Common exposures include birds, such as in those who race pigeons or breed birds. And these birds have feather dust, a characteristic bloom or dust, even on healthy birds, or they create dust in their pigeon droppings or bird droppings. And it's this particle that then gets inhaled and develops HP. Other causes include things like mold from water damage or mold in the home, particularly mold on hay in farmers, moldy wood used in woodworking, and other sources of exposures. And of course, a lot of us are exposed to birds and mold, but not all of us develop HP. So there's also a lot of other factors that researchers are still discovering, such as genetics and other exposures, which means that people develop HP more likely than other people. So how does HP affect the lungs? Well, these exposures cause a reaction in the lungs. These exposures invite a lot of inflammatory cells, and that causes an inflammation or inflammatory reaction. And after time, that can also cause scarring or fibrosis. This leads to people with HP experiencing things like breathlessness because the lungs cannot expand properly. People might experience cough because the tubes and the sacs get irritated. People with HP might experience fatigue. They have difficulty doing their usual activities, and they might develop low lung function. And of course, different people with HP experience these symptoms differently. So how is HP diagnosed? Well, it involves a number of different components. There's a doctor interview, which asks about your symptoms, but also asks about your work history, really trying to work out your history of exposures and other risk factors that makes HP more likely in you. As well as having a doctor interview, you'll also have a CT scan that gets a really good picture of what's happening in the lungs. Usually people also have blood tests, lung function tests, and sometimes if we're uncertain about the diagnosis, you'll even have a bronchoscopy or a lung biopsy. So what do CT scans in people with HP show? Well, this is a normal CT scan. This is the left lung and this is the right lung, and we've got the heart in the middle here. And you can see here that it's mostly black, and that's what we would expect. And then these white lines here are the blood vessels that are taking the oxygenated blood away from the lungs into the heart. So this is a normal scan. And if you look here on a patient with HP, you can see that this scan Shows a lot more fluffy dots. And this area is the inflammation that we were talking about. And you can also see that we're starting to see some thick lines forming here on the CT, and that's the scarring. And you can see here in this CT, you can understand why this person might have more difficulty breathing than this person, because their lungs look a little bit different. And so what do lung function tests in people with HP show, and why do we do lung function? This is an example of someone having a lung function test, sitting in the box with a peg on their nose and breathing as hard and fast as they can. And we do lung function tests to measure the capacity of lungs. And it's helpful because people with HP sometimes have reduced total lung capacity. And we also use lung function tests to track changes over time and response to treatment. And sometimes after we've done the doctor interview and the CT scan and the lung function tests, we might not be certain about the diagnosis, and we might need to do a bronchoscopy or even a biopsy. This is only done if it's really necessary. A bronchoscopy is a lung washing where the doctor puts patient to sleep and puts the bronchoscopy tube in through their nose and down into their lungs. It has a little camera on the end, and the doctor can have a look at their lungs. And then we also take a washing of the lungs and count how many inflammatory cells are in the lungs, and that helps us with the diagnosis. A lung biopsy is performed similarly, and it takes a very small piece of the lung. We can look at that piece of lung under the microscope to get a better picture of the process that's happening inside the lung. So you might ask, why is HP diagnosis so hard? Why do you have to have so many tests? Why are doctors still not certain at the end of all your tests? Well, the difficulty is that there is no single one test for HP diagnosis, and HP can look very similar to other ILDs like pulmonary fibrosis or ILDs that result from rheumatoid arthritis and so on. And HP does look a little bit different from pulmonary fibrosis in that there's a lot more inflammation in HP compared to pulmonary fibrosis, but sometimes these conditions can all look quite similar to each other. But it is important to get the diagnosis right, because different conditions often need different treatments. So usually the doctor takes a combination of all these investigations and they take it to a multidisciplinary team meeting to discuss. A multidisciplinary team meeting has multiple specialists who attend the meeting, and research shows that patients get a more accurate diagnosis of their HP or of their ILD if cases are presented at a multidisciplinary team meeting. So it really is the standard of care for ILD patients. So really, I think HP diagnosis is a journey. It starts off with some symptoms. Initially, the patient will see their GP, then they'll be referred to a respiratory doctor, and then they might have to have a number of different tests before they get to the diagnosis and treatment. And sometimes that can be frustrating for patients because they really want to get their answer, especially once they see the respiratory doctor. They think, well, why don't they just start me on treatment right now? Why do I have to wait even longer? But in my mind, I think it's better to take a longer journey and get to the right destination than to hurry along the journey and get to the wrong destination, because it really does make a difference in terms of what we call it and what treatments are available. So let's talk a little bit about HP treatment. Because HP is often caused by or is contributed by exposures, it's really important to remove current exposures to prevent further damage. So if patients own birds and we think that birds are contributing, then the first step in treatment is to remove the birds as best as possible so that there's less further damage on their lungs. This can be very effective if the exposure is current, and some people might not even need medications after the exposure is removed. Of course, some people might have been exposed 10 years, 20 years ago, and they might not be exposed to that antigen anymore, and so the removal of exposure is less relevant in them. For people who are experiencing symptoms and if they have low lung function, the doctor might talk about using anti-inflammatory medications such as prednisolone, a steroid, or other steroid-sparing agents. And these can range from being mildly or very effective, depending on the features of HP. They, of course, have potential side effects, and so it's important to discuss with your doctor if that's right for you. More recently, we've had anti-scarring medication come available for patients with HP. We have one available called nintedanib, but there are other anti-scarring medications out there. And this can be effective in reducing further scarring, but it certainly doesn't cure the disease. There are other treatments that are relevant to people with HP and any other ILD. Pulmonary rehabilitation is a supervised exercise program and is really being shown in research to be effective in improving people's exercise tolerance, but also providing advice and support with similarly minded patients. Oxygen therapy in those who need it. Lung transplantation is performed in rare cases. And of course, we shouldn't forget clinical trials, which is an opportunity to test new therapies and have access to new therapies. And I think when you think about what the right treatment is for you, it's important to remember that people with HP have different features that might respond to different treatments. And you can ask your doctor, what treatments are right for me? I often think it's about balancing the benefits and the risks. The benefits of how effective is this treatment based on my condition? Will this make me feel better? Will it improve my breathlessness or cough? Will it improve my lung function or will my CT improve? Will it improve my quality of life or quantity of life? And then also asking about the potential risks with any treatments. What are the common side effects? Which side effects am I more likely to get? Can the side effects be well managed? Do I have other medical conditions which make these medications less safe for me? And what other options do I have if I don't have this particular treatment? So I think these questions are really important to ask your doctor about any treatment that you're about to embark on. And so when you've received a diagnosis of HP, what does your journey look like? Well, it involves you meeting with a respiratory doctor regularly, trialing these treatments that I've talked about, monitoring for improvement and side effects, re-evaluating the picture and thinking whether we need to try a different treatment. It involves performing regular lung function to have an objective measure of tracking change over time. And people with HP can have a different journey. Some people can get improvement after they remove the exposure or have treatment. Some people stabilize. Some people have a slow decline. And some people have an up and down journey with a rapid decline. Sometimes it can be hard to predict which journey you're going to take at the start at diagnosis. And sometimes we need a bit of passage of time and see how you're tracking along to kind of predict or determine which of these disease trajectories you're going to take. And of course, every time we have new treatments available, that might change your disease journey as well. So who can help you with your treatment or on your journey with HP? Your GP can be a really good initial point of call. While they might not know a lot about ILD, they know you well, and then they might know what's right for you. Your respiratory doctor, particularly your ILD specialist, is a really good point of call. The ILD nurses that are associated with specialist hospitals are really excellent resources in helping you manage side effects, answering your questions. Sometimes you might feel a bit nervous about asking the doctors particular questions, and I really encourage you to ask the ILD nurses because they're so lovely and approachable. Of course, you can go to the pulmonary rehabilitation and ask physiotherapists and other patients. And the Lung Foundation Australia and other patient education and support groups have a lot of resources and supports available. Sometimes people with HP might feel a bit down about having this diagnosis, and that's really understandable, especially if you've been a very high functioning, really well person previously. It can be hard to come to grips with the fact that you have this new diagnosis. The research shows that some people feel down about not being able to do the activities that they used to do. And how we might manage that is enrolling in pulmonary rehab, which will improve your exercise tolerance and also give you a chance to talk to people about that, adjusting activities and asking for help, whether that be your caregivers, people around you, and also your doctors. Some people feel frustrated about a really long journey to diagnosis or a lack of answers about why it's happened to them. And if you feel like that, talk to your doctors, ask about what research is being done in this area, and ask about if there's more answers given the passage of time about why this has happened to you. Some people might feel frustrated that there's no cure. And again, I encourage you to talk to your doctors and ask about clinical trials or things that are coming out, because there's lots of research in this area and there's always hope. Specifically with HP, some people might feel down or guilty about their exposure that they might have had at work, or it's from a pet bird, and that's potentially contributed to their disease. And talk to your doctor about really how this has contributed. And also remember that you can't do much about what's happened before, but maybe you can just make changes for the future in terms of your exposures. What are doctors and researchers doing about HP? As I've outlined, there's certainly a lot of work still to be done in getting an accurate diagnosis about understanding why this condition occurs. We, of course, need new and effective treatments. And specifically, we need treatments that help people feel better, improve their cough, improve their breathlessness, not only improving their lung function. And there's a lot of doctors in Australia, as well as overseas, who are doing a lot of good research in HP. So this is an evolving area. What can you do? If you'd like to, you can certainly be involved in research. You can enroll in patient registries that groups together big groups of patients so this condition can be better studied and is more of a real world understanding of what patients experience and what they're like. And that's really helpful in informing research. If it's right for you, you could join a clinical trial. This is medical research that tests new treatments that, if successful, can be approved and made available to the wider public and potentially can be of benefit to you. And of course, you can lobby and support charity and governments to put money into this research to get better outcomes for our patients. So if you want to find out more information about HP or any other ILD, I'd encourage you to speak to your GP, your ILD doctor, and the ILD nurse. And of course, Lung Foundation Australia and other patient support groups have really excellent education resources about how to find support services, how to get involved, resources such as brochures and webinars such as these. So really tap into those resources. So thanks very much. I'll stop there and I'll hand over to Jamie, who will then introduce Ted, and we'll take questions at the end.
Thanks so much, Hayley. It's very valuable and supportive information that we can connect patients in with throughout many stages of their journey. So thank you so much. Ted, we really appreciate you joining us today to share your experience of living with hypersensitivity pneumonitis. So when you're ready, I'll hand over to you.
Thank you, Jamie. And thank you, Hayley, because all of the insights that we get into hypersensitive pneumonitis are a great help, because there's some pretty bleak commentary out there if you do go online to try and learn more. Much better to hear from those like Hayley, who speak with great authority on this subject. For my part, I'd like to just share a few of my experiences living with this disease. Look, everyone's experience will be different, but I hope that mine might provide an example of how it is possible to live a good life with this disease, particularly for those who are newly diagnosed. Certainly, I, as Hayley referred to, had some dark days early on because my father had died of the ILD sarcoidosis at age 78. I am 81. I do not know how long I might have had this disease. I did have birds when I was an adolescent, and I had some lung scarring from double pneumonia and pleurisy when I was age 12. But 5 years ago, I suddenly developed a wheeze, only at night when I went to bed, and it didn't go away. So I was otherwise well. I had no other symptoms. And I did finally go to the GP with much prompting from my wife. There was an X-ray, and the next day a call from the surgery asking me to come back and see the GP that afternoon. The call ended with the cheery, "Don't worry, it's not lung cancer." And that was my introduction to interstitial lung disease. I have to say, although Hayley's referred to the importance of getting the journey right in the diagnosis, I confess to having wasted much valuable time. I had meetings with specialists interested in pursuing abnormal proteins. I had a bronchoscopy that Hayley referred to, found inflammation cells. Then I went on to a steroid puffer, which fixed the wheeze. And with the wheeze gone and feeling fine, there was really a long delay on my part in pursuing the matter any further. I didn't really see the need. COVID, I suppose, played a part in all of this, but really it was complacency, I think, on my part. I really didn't have a clear diagnosis of my condition during these early years. Look, good sense ultimately prevailed, and for the last 18 months, I've been treated through the ILD clinic at RPA Hospital in Sydney. And I can't speak more highly of the attention I've received from the clinic. And I was diagnosed with hypersensitive pneumonitis. So out went the suspicious items like the feather pillow and the compost bin. But I have to say, I don't think I have ever identified something in the environment which has and continues to trigger this condition. I would just emphasise the importance of getting to the right specialist services that people like Hayley provide. And whilst that might pose particularly difficulty for people in regional rural areas, it really is so vital to do so. The situation is now, I take a solid amount of medication. I take the mycophenolate that Hayley referred to, plus some steroid as well, and happily have very little in the way of side effects from all of that. And presently, my situation is that my lung function sits at 57% and has been about this level for the last 12 months. That's good news because it shows the progression of the disease in my case can be managed. And the question, what effect does this level of lung function have on what I do? Well, I think the answer to that is really not much. I find 57% is fine for me to lead an active life. Look, I've never been a fitness fanatic, but I've always led an active lifestyle. I've been a swimmer for much of my life. And I find now that regular exercise is still, I think, essential in my everyday life. I can do all sorts of things. I garden, I help out on our daughter's farm. I continue, as I say, to do exercise. I still swim a few laps with lots of rests in between. I spend about 30 to 40 minutes paddling on a stand-up paddleboard, often longer when there's a headwind, and I can do all that is necessary around our house. You know, I use a chainsaw sometimes. I pave and I do decking. And recently I've been collecting sandstone blocks and building a stone retaining wall. So having said all that, let me just emphasise I'm really not special. I puff going uphill, and talking and walking can be tricky. Long flights of stairs are a challenge for me, and I have to stop regularly to admire the view or check the phone. But having said that, I've still climbed the hundreds of stairs from Pittwater to Barrenjoey Lighthouse with our grandchildren. Like everyone else, I find there are good days in which I can walk up hills without too much effort, and others in which I can really feel that constriction in trying to take deep breaths. But I find it's important to push on because the exercise is key to being well and feeling well. And there are lung and cardiac rehabilitation exercises that may be available in your area. I was referred to one and have recently started, and really I found it excellent to get you into the routine of regular exercise. I also believe that the level of fitness does help with the vulnerability to infections, and the warning certainly I received that an infection might adversely affect my lung function. This is a concern because you always worry about how much you might travel away from the sort of services to which you are connected locally. So when the prospect of a trip to India arose in our family, I was concerned initially about going and being isolated from my medical support if I did pick up an infection. But we did go last November and had a wonderful time, despite some pretty poor air quality. But what I didn't know was that it was necessary, in my case anyway, to do a lung function test beforehand to determine if I could fly without oxygen being available. Luckily, I could. Otherwise, there's a very large cost associated with it, I gather. Mind you, I did pick up an infection. Happily, neither it nor COVID in July last year had any significant effect on my lung function. But I was quick to get medical help, and I think it's very important to do so. But I found that reassuring that infections are always a risk, but it's a risk that may not come at the sort of high price that might have otherwise been expected. Look, speaking to the people at the ILD clinic last month when I had my last appointment, it gave me a sense of the amazing interstitial lung disease research underway in this country, and Hayley has referred to this. And look, I was really confident after that discussion, because this is work that is in a collegiate capacity across the country in which so many different people are united in a common task to help us all. And it was just quite amazing. And I'm confident there'll be big advances in treatment and who knows, perhaps restoration of lung function for those much younger than I. Look, can I just conclude by saying that in my case, I found a good quality of life despite losing almost half of my lung function. And I hope my experience with this disease may encourage others not to be too deeply troubled by the effect it may have on your life. It is possible to go on living side by side with this condition, but really doing so at a very, very good quality of life. I'm always grateful for the support I've received. We are very blessed with the institutions that support us, and in particular, the Foundation of Australia, so ably represented by Jamie. I thank all for the opportunity to speak today, and good health to all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ted. It's lovely to hear from you and hear of your journey, and that you've, you know, linked in with a lot of things and been able to manage your condition so well also. So to hear of that, I'm sure will no doubt will be of value to many people. So thank you. We might continue the conversation now and jump into our Q&A session. So I might start with Hayley. I'll direct this one to you around remission or remission of symptoms. Is there a time frame, like how long can remission last of hypersensitivity pneumonitis or its symptoms?
Every patient is really different. And if there has been just a lot of inflammation in the lungs and not a lot of scarring, and if the exposure is able to be removed and often immunosuppression is used, sometimes people can go into remission. That means that their CT looks almost normal, that their lung function comes back to normal, and that they feel a lot better. If the exposure was, you know, that they were suddenly exposed and then that exposure was removed, they might be in remission for a very long time after that. Sometimes people have some symptoms and they have some changes in their CT and we start treatment and their symptoms improve. They're not necessarily in remission, but they're, I guess, well treated. And that can last for a number of years as well. As Ted alluded to, that's almost kind of what his experience has been. He's still got the condition, but his symptoms have improved. And so I guess we think of that as well treated. And that can last for many, many years forever. Not everybody develops scarring, not everybody develops progression, and everybody's journey is a little bit different.
Hayley, I might direct this one to you first, and then Ted, if there's anything you'd like to add. I know you touched on it earlier in terms of virus and COVID. But Hayley, can I expect with every cold or virus that I'll get a flare up with my HP?
It's a good question. Not necessarily. You might in general feel that you get more shortness of breath, cough, and feel lousy just because of the virus or cold itself. It may not flare up your disease, especially if you're on immunosuppression, and it doesn't necessarily create a lasting adverse impact that you can't recover from. I think it's important, though, to try and reduce the risk of infections where possible. So if it's right for you, having flu vaccines, COVID vaccines, pneumococcal vaccines, we've all become much more aware about hand hygiene, avoiding public spaces where there's going to be a lot of people potentially infected, or getting your friends and family to not come to events when they potentially have an infection. So I think there are things that you could potentially do to try and reduce your risk of infections.
Thank you. Ted, is there anything that you'd like to add based on your experience?
Mine has been certainly the infections, because I'm on immunosuppressants, take longer to resolve than would in a normal case. But yeah, it's important to get treatment. I make sure I do get some treatment quite quickly, and I get my lungs checked to make sure I really don't have any problems sort of within the lungs, at least upper respiratory, or at least located in my head. But what was I going to say? I was going to make some point further to Hayley's, but 81, you don't always remember them too clearly. So yeah, avoiding infections, great. But I have one of our children has younger grandchildren, and they are just a constant risk. And you just can't avoid having close contact with them. I mean, it sort of diminishes your life to do so. And whilst you're aware of the risk they propose, you still wouldn't avoid the time with them in any circumstances. So I think it's a balance. As Hayley says, be as careful as you can, but don't cut yourself off from so much that is important to our social lives.
Nice way to put it. Thank you. We did get another one come through in regards to the difference of pulmonary fibrosis to hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Or the fibrotic form of hypersensitivity pneumonitis as well. Is there a difference between them?
Yeah, it's a really great question. And I think about pulmonary fibrosis as really about the scarring side of things. So the lungs are scarred, and the cells that are involved are those scarring cells. And when we think about HP, we think about it both as an inflammatory disease. So there's lots of inflammation in the lungs, and sometimes there's also scarring. I think that's different in terms of the mechanism of action and how the condition is. It's also different in terms of the treatment, because we wouldn't necessarily give steroids to pulmonary fibrosis, because steroids don't seem to help scarring, whereas we might give it to HP patients because it will address the inflammation. And also, if you read about things on Google, you read pulmonary fibrosis has a poor life expectancy. I think, just to be clear, that's probably not the case anymore now that we have new drugs available. But if you have HP and you don't have scarring, then your life expectancy would be even better than someone with pulmonary fibrosis. I guess they're kind of linked in some way, but in some way they're a little bit different.
Okay, thank you. And I know you went into treatment earlier, Hayley, but we've had a question come through. If there are any other available medications other than Ofev on the market?
So Ofev is an anti-scarring medication, also called nintedanib. And at the moment for HP, that's the only anti-scarring medication available. For IPF, there are two anti-scarring medications, Ofev or nintedanib plus pirfenidone or Esbriet. Those studies in HP and Esbriet have not yet been done. So Esbriet is not available for HP patients at the moment. Those are the only two anti-scarring medications currently available in Australia on the PBS, and the only the Ofev is available for HP patients. There are, however, a number of clinical trials happening at the moment. There's several really exciting phase three clinical trials. Phase three meaning they've already gone through initial phases and now we're doing the final phases. And if they show some improvement, then it might be available to the general public. So I think that there is some hope for newer medications in the next couple of years.
Thank you. Ted, in terms of sort of helping your friends and family understand your condition, is there a way that you communicate this with them?
All I tend to say is just that there's something organic, something environmental that triggers a response from the immune system that leads to inflammation and some damage to the lungs. I don't know why. Maybe no one sort of wants to venture into this area, but I don't. I mean, people know I have this lung condition which restricts my activities, but no one really, beyond the little information that I have given them. I'm happy to talk about it to anyone, but most people seem comfortable with, I think, the effect it has more on the nature of the condition. I think if it had more effect perhaps on what I do, maybe they'd be more interested to understand the mechanism involved. But I just, that's all I do, simply say something environmental that is causing this inflammatory reaction in the lungs, and that I've never been able to identify it, and who knows when it might have occurred.
Thank you. Hayley, in terms of, just got a question come through. So in terms of long-term patients, is it common for symptoms to expand, I suppose, to other areas of the body, so skin problems, stomach, bladder issues?
Yeah, thanks for that question. And I guess on one hand, this is a sign that some people with HP can live a very long time with the current therapies that we have. But as you point out, some of these therapies do have potential side effects. Medications such as prednisolone, the longer that we use them, the more potential for side effects to affect other organs in the body, bone health, gut health, and so on. And I guess it's important to keep monitoring for side effects with your doctor. Sometimes you might talk to your doctor about whether this is still the right medication for you, or can we switch to an agent that potentially has less side effects in you and is still very effective. But yes, it can be a common problem in not only those with HP, but all these patients who are on immunosuppression medications.
Could I just add that I start off on fairly high doses of, I know Hayley calls it prednisolone. I, for some reason, seem to have got prednisone in my head. And then I've gradually come down, but I am stuck at the moment on 5 milligrams daily. And I am desperate to get off because of all of the reasons Hayley has alluded to, but I'm not allowed to. It's such a slow process. I am told that maybe by the end of this year that it may be possible to do so, but I have to be have a lung function test as I go down step by step. So I'll drop to 2.5 maybe by springtime, and then hopefully off that both, you know, a wonderful and a cursed drug. Great in the short term, but as Hayley says, not so good in the long term. So it can be a slow process to break the sort of connection with it, certainly in my case.
I think that will bring us to the end of our Q&A session. Just before we do close the webinar, I did just want to take a moment to direct everyone to the patient resources that we have on the Lung Foundation website. I know Hayley mentioned before, and here you can access a wide range of resources for people living with PF and IPF, including our new Hypersensitivity Pneumonitis fact sheet as well. And we've got a number of peer support programs that you may be able to connect in with as well. So these can be accessed via the website And also you've got the two QR codes there that are on the screen that can take you directly to the resource hub and also to the find out more about the peer support options. So I'll wrap up there and thank you again, Ted and Hayley, and everyone that's joined us today. We really hope that everyone listening was able to gain something from today's webinar. So with that, I'll say goodbye and close the session for today. So thank you.